Intermittent fasting, lose weight, heal your body, and live a healthy life. Written by Amanda Walker. Narrated by Kimberly Austin. Introduction. Unless you've been in a coma for the past few decades, you're no doubt aware that there's a worrisome epidemic afflicting millions of people all over the globe. That epidemic is obesity, excessive weight that leads to physical and mental health problems that affect quality of life. The latest buzz is about belly fat, which is the term that has been coined to describe abdominal obesity. The common occurrence of this phenomenon is clearly evident to the most casual observer on a bus or in the shopping mall. In fact, the words belly fat have become a sort of battle cry of health professionals and nutritionists who recognize the dangers lurking behind all that fat. Excessive weight in general, and belly fat in particular, have all sorts of negative effects on your body, your heart, and even your brain. Increased weight means an increased risk of developing heart problems, type 2 diabetes, inflammatory diseases, and cancer. Looking at the big picture, a larger waist circumference can lead to a shorter life. As much as we try to fool ourselves with lame excuses, the principal cause of this problem is pretty clear. We eat too much. But it's more than that. Many of the foods we eat are poor sources of nutrients. In our quest for foods that are convenient and tasty, we often forego the right kinds of foods that we need for a healthy life. We have become a society that tends to eat whatever we want, whenever we want, wherever we can get it. Then one day, something happens. We step on the scale, or we see our reflection in a mirror, or we can't get our jeans on. And we think, oh, choose your favorite expletive. It's time to do something. And the first thing that comes to mind is the D word, diet. But now there's another problem. In the late 1970s, the USDA recommended a low-fat diet, and that seems to be just about the point at which the rate of obesity began its statistical climb. In cutting down on fats, people began to consume more carbohydrates, which stimulate insulin levels. High insulin levels actually make people gain weight, rather than losing it. That was the opposite of what the USDA intended. When the recommended low-fat diets didn't produce the desired results, more diets began to come out of the woodwork. We went from the low-fat to low-carb to slow-carb, Atkins, South Beach, Zone, Mediterranean, all liquid, all vegetable, all fruit, all raw, and so on, and so on. Companies like Jenny Craig and Nutrisystem also jumped on the diet bandwagon, and SlimFast and AIDS developed products to help in the weight loss effort. The results were mixed. Many of these diets were successful with a lot of people, but many were not. That's the thing about dieting. What works for one person won't work for another. Finding a diet that's perfect for everybody has just not been accomplished at this point. That's why diet books continue to be hot items in bookstores and libraries everywhere. One refrain that seems to prevail among all the diets is the question, what can I eat today? With all the calorie counting, fat counting, carb counting, etc., we often find that our daily choices are limited. But what if there were some days where, instead of saying, what can I eat today, you could say, what will I eat today? It's not just wishful thinking that you would be able to eat whatever you liked on a diet. With intermittent fasting, it's a reality. That doesn't mean that you'll be wolfing down giant portions of ice cream and French fries at will. With intermittent fasting, there will still be some restrictions. The difference is that you will not be restricting what you eat, but when you eat. And not only will you lose weight, You'll also become healthier in the process. Part 1. What is intermittent fasting? What is intermittent fasting, and why is it good for you? By definition, intermittent fasting, or IF, means that a person has regularly scheduled periods of time where she eats a normal diet, alternating with periods of restricted eating. In other words, it's a pattern of skipping meals on a regular basis. Restricted eating could be anything from zero calories to a small quantity of food with a significantly minimized calorie total. For some people, it's a more effective way to lose weight than the other diet plans. At first, it's not easy. The hunger pains during the fasting periods are impossible to ignore, and there's a constant need to watch the clock. But after a brief period of adjustment, the hunger pains become insignificant, and the routine of intermittent fasting begins to fit right into the daily groove. Some people will balk at the idea of not being able to indulge in their 3 to 6 meals a day, but if you think about it, you're already fasting every time you sleep. That's why the first meal of the day is called breakfast. You're breaking the fast between the last meal of yesterday and the first meal of today. So how hard can it be to just fast a bit longer and wait a while for the first meal? Once your body gets adjusted to fasting on a regular timetable, your insulin and glucose levels will calm down. More on this later. And your brain won't be sending as many false alarms that you need to eat. The longer you maintain a regular fasting pattern, the easier it becomes. One problem with our eating habits is just that. They are based on habit. Breakfast at 7:30 a.m., lunch at noon on the dot, snacks at 10 and 3, and dinner at 6 with ice cream in front of the TV. And don't forget the requisite guacamole and chips while you watch football. All this, whether you're hungry or not. With intermittent fasting, you become more aware of your hunger levels. If there are certain times or circumstances where you eat because that's what you've always done, being on a fast means that you won't eat during those times. And eventually, it will lead you to wonder why it was always such a big deal in the first place. With intermittent fasting, your attitude toward eating becomes more purposeful, and you become more focused on your eating patterns. Once your attention is centered more on when you will eat than what you can eat, you no longer have to be as concerned with trying to eat less. As long as you don't try to overcompensate by binging between fasts, your average calorie count will naturally decrease, and you'll lose weight. The idea of intermittent fasting as a weight loss or health improvement diet program is relatively new. For that reason, there has not been a lot of research done to verify all the anecdotal evidence from people who have tried it and are impressed with the results. According to some, the weight loss and loss of belly fat was remarkable. Not only that, but compared to eating a low-calorie diet with no fasting period, the weight loss is just as effective, and possibly even more effective. But there is less muscle loss. Is IF a good idea for everyone? Unfortunately, no. For people with certain health conditions, diabetes or malnutrition, for example, intermittent fasting could mean a serious risk to their health. And people with eating disorders would only aggravate their condition if they adopted the practice of intermittent fasting. Additionally, children, as well as women who are pregnant or breastfeeding, should not have nutritional restrictions. And before you make the decision whether intermittent fasting is for you, it's important to take into consideration any prescription meds that you take on a regular basis. If you happen to be on a medication that needs to be taken with food, fasting won't work for you. So the bottom line here is the same as with any type of diet. Do not proceed until you check all the facts and get the go-ahead from your healthcare provider.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.